Championship Wrestling 82. I'm Gordon Soley, your host. With me is Take Five's Barbara Clary and Jerry Briscoe. And on behalf of Barbara and Jerry and our entire staff here on Championship Wrestling 82, may we extend at this time to each and every one of you a very, very happy new year. We hope that the 1982 will be a happy, healthy, and prosperous new year for each and every one of you. And a lot of big things upcoming here on Championship Wrestling during 1982. Jerry, first of all, some new faces and then some well-known faces returning to Florida.
Well, Gordon, some big news and some well-known faces fits all in the mold of Andre the Giant, who'll be returning to the Sunshine State real soon. Andre was featured in Sports Illustrated, a national publication going around worldwide, and it's quite a story on Andre the Giant. Also coming to Championship Wrestling in Florida is a young man by the name of Butch Reed, former Kansas City Chief All-Star linebacker, also All-American for Central State Missouri University. Also, Gordon, he was heavyweight champion at Central Missouri State, and this man, he is quite a package.
He is indeed. I've seen Bruce Butch Reed in action many times in the past. Currently, he's been on tour throughout Europe. He'll be here in the near future talking about other greats, too. Roger Kirby, former junior heavyweight champion of the world, still holds a record for leg presses, and of course, David Von Erich, second-generation wrestler, and then there's Killer Carl Cox, a man who, has met with mixed emotions.
Well, Killer Carl Cox certainly has his own following. He is his following. He has a friend, Alex, that he claims helps him out in tight situations. And whether he does or whether he doesn't, only Killer Carl Cox knows, but he is quite a unique personality.
It is indeed. And we have two new champions. And, Barbara, your Take Five today will concern one of the new champions.
Yes, Gordon, we have a new Southern heavyweight champion, and I'll be talking with him on Take Five.
All right, that's all upcoming. And we do have a new Florida television champion as well. As many of you know, of course, this past week at the Bayfront Center in St. Petersburg, a one-night round-robin tournament was held to determine the new Florida TV champion. And I might point out, Jerry, it was a non-stop tournament.
Well, that's right, Gordon. This is a really grueling tournament. We're a non-stop continuation tournament. The first man in the ring, he wrestles until he's defeated. As soon as, if he is defeated, or if he captures a fall or a submission hold on his opponent, the next man crawls into the ring without a rest period. So you've got to be in condition. You've got to be ready on not only mentally tough, but physically tough.
And we're going to join now this round-robin tournament in the closing moments. And you'll find it's Ron Ritchie going up against Eric Embry. And it is Ritchie here with a full body slam on Eric Embry. And Embry having an increasing problem with his back, as you can see here. Embry really beginning to suffer now. He had already competed earlier, and now Ron Ritchie pressing to full advantage, using a backbreaker. But once again, a very gutty, very determined Embry powers out from a salto here. It is Embry again, and you can see that problem with his back. And yet, again, we watch the man utilizing the ring ropes this time. He's a good little ring general.
Well, Eric Embry has really matured, Gordon, since he's been in the Sunshine State. He's learned to position himself in the ring, and that's very important. Here you see he got a little anxious. He went up for that drop kick. He was injured. He was favoring his back, and when you favor something, you tend to miss it. Here we see Ron Ritchie come down with a big, giant power slam, and most people do not get up with it. He goes right back to his favorite move, the power slam again, and this is remarkable what Eric Embry does here. He's able to kick out with that injured back.
Catches him in a rolling block and has him down for that count of three. And Eric Embry, a very, very tired but very, very jubilant athlete, on his back, but he has won the Florida Television Championship in a one-night round-robin tournament, a fine display of sportsmanship here, both men congratulating each other. This trophy, of course, will be presented to Eric Embry, signifying the Florida TV Championship for 1982. Also, this plaque will be given to him as a permanent reminder of the fact that he has won the Florida Television Championship. Eric was going to be with us this morning, but is at the doctor's right now having that back looked after. Hopefully, we'll have him here a little bit later on in the program, and we'll be able to talk to him a little bit more about the fact that he is the Florida TV Champion. But I would say, of course, during the next hour, Jerry, we've got a lot of great action coming up.
Well, that's right. We also have, in my opinion, one of the greatest masked men wrestlers of all time, Mr. Wrestling Number 2. This man is a tough, tough man.
And we're going to be seeing for the first time here on Championship Wrestling 82 the combination of Iron Mike and Chan Chung two of the latest arrivals in the camp of one J.J. Dillon. Former world heavyweight champion Dory Funk Jr. will be here. David Von Erich will be watching Mike Graham in action. And an interesting take five, as Barbara mentioned, with the new Southern heavyweight champion. All of this and much, much more, including the world junior heavyweight champion coming up. We'll be back with more matches in just a moment. Well, as you know, of course, the Championship Wrestling film crew travels all over the United States, filming matches of great import and great interest to everyone. And this past week, of course, Championship Wrestling's film crew was in Orlando at the Eddie Graham Sports Stadium to cover the wrestling matches there. Of course, the Eddie Graham Sports Stadium, the home of all sorts of events all year long. But, of course, each and every week, Championship Wrestling is held there. And there was a very, very important Florida title match between Wahoo McDaniel and the Spoiler.
Well, that's right, Gordon, and the roof was really raised on this match here. Wahoo McDaniel's, everybody knows it, full-blood Chickasaw Choctaw Indian from the state of Oklahoma, and when his temper gets riled, it's like you better circle the wagons because the Indian goes on the warpath.
And we're going to see exactly what happened right now as the Spoiler, managed by J.J. Dillon, faces the stiffest competition he's faced all last year for the Florida Heavyweight Championship. There you see him, Wahoo McDaniel, the man who still holds athletic records at the University of Oklahoma. A single leg pickup, actually an ankle sweep into a toe hold on the Spoiler, the Florida Heavyweight Champion on the canvas. There you see J.J. Dillon, the man who, has been known for years to surround himself with only the finest of wrestlers and in fact now the Florida Heavyweight Champion, the Spoiler, under contract. But right now it is Wahoo McDaniels looking to take that title away from him.
Well, Gordon, you try to keep J.J. Dillon out of your mind. You try to keep your concentration in the ring. But his biggest asset, he moves around that ring. He knows how to get your attention. Once he gets your attention, you take it off for a fraction of a second. It opens you up for this big Spoiler to lay something on you, just as he did Wahoo McDaniels. And Gordon, it's very, very dangerous when the Spoiler gets loose, when he gets some distance on you because of the long body. He's able to get up on these ropes as he's doing now, use them for his leverage. And with the size of this man, when he comes pouncing down on you, it's like a ton of bricks hitting you in the head.
He has uncanny balance, great agility, and tremendous power. He is actually the combination, I guess, of what any person would look for in just a great all-around athlete. And he's got Wahoo McDaniel in trouble here now, put the claw on him. And again, you can see that J.J. Dillon has to be a factor in this situation. There's no question about that. But once again, the Spoiler clamps down with the claw. And I would say that, it's just a great credit to the capabilities, the perseverance, and the intestinal fortitude of Wahoo McDaniel that he was able to withstand the pressure of this claw.
Wahoo McDaniels was never on a losing football team season-long, wise Gordon. He had never been on a losing wrestling team. The man knows what victory's about. He's had victories all over the world, and he is a winner.
Spoiler off those ropes once again, down on Wahoo McDaniel. And it is McDaniel here in a lot of trouble. Once again, the referee, Bill Alfonso, doing a fine job of officiating. And they're very close. They're up against those ropes. The referee calls for the break. And it is the Spoiler again, pressing his advantage, now moves outside the ring, up onto that top rope. And here you see this tremendous balance capability that he has. He's caught by Wahoo McDaniel and dropped to the canvas. McDaniel back to his feet. Stalks his man, and one thing about Wahoo McDaniel, you just never count him out.
Well, you don't. You see Wahoo taking his time going in there. He's very sure of what he does. Although that temper gets away from him at times, Wahoo's on the attack. He throws those chops, and you can hear those chops all the way across the state, Gordon, when he starts throwing them.
The Spoiler, feeling the effect of that, driven back to the canvas, back on his feet once again. The referee, of course, knocked outside the ring at this point in time. And here is where I want you to watch very, very carefully. McDaniel catches his man, has him down. No question about this. The Spoiler is down, but the referee out of action. And there you see J.J. Dillon coming off that top rope, crashing down across the back of Wahoo McDaniel, breaking the pinning combination that McDaniel had. Now, It is J.J. Dillon then pushing the referee back inside. The referee totally unaware of what had happened. And J.J. Dillon, in his devious manner, brings the referee back in. The spoiler getting credit here, a three count. The spoiler getting credit here for a victory. But that victory is to be short-lived indeed, because here comes Killer Carl Cox. And he is very quick to inform the referee is exactly what did happen. The fact that J.J. Dillon came off the ropes. And now Killer Carl Cox, as only this man can be, emphasizing his point with the referee, now rendering assistance to Wahoo McDaniel. Of course, the enmity, the animosity, the anger between Killer Carl Cox and J.J. Dillon is known worldwide.
It goes way back, Gordon. It's not only here in the state of Florida. Cox has told me that he's looked at Dillon many, many years. He's rounded him up. Here we see just exactly what the spoiler and Dillon is capable of doing.
There you see J.J. Dillon once again up on that top rope as the referee and Cox knocked to one side. But there you see Cox charging back in. And Killer Carl Cox, an extremely resourceful man, will use anything at his side or near him to make sure that what he sets out to accomplish, he will in fact accomplish.
The spoiler disqualified. The fact that you would take the liberty of showing this tape, the fact that you would approve of the likes of Killer Carl Cox taking a weapon like a chair, striking the Florida heavyweight champion, the spoiler, across the back, chasing me like some kind of a wild man. Killer Carl Cox should be contained at all times. He's a madman. I tried to hail him at one time in Australia a few years ago. He wouldn't listen to me. He won't listen to anybody. He's a dangerous man. He should be barred from professional wrestling. And I feel it's an insult to even show his face to these people.
Well, Mr. Dillon, you may feel it's an insult. I certainly don't. I don't think any of you do either. The spoiler disqualified, of course, did retain his title, but he learned a lesson both from Wahoo McDaniel and from Killer Carl Cox. We'll be back with Mike Graham in action right after we pause for these words.
This match, one fall with a 10-minute time limit, from Tampa, Florida, weighing 219 pounds, Mike Graham. His opponent from Dunlap, Kansas, weighing 265 pounds, Hangman Bobby Jaggers.
Hangman Bobby Jaggers moving out against Mike Graham. Mike Graham giving away about, I'm going to say, close to 50 pounds here against Jaggers. And but with the capabilities of Mike Graham and the tremendous power that he has, being a former powerlifting champion and three times a state AAU amateur wrestling champion, that weight differential isn't really going to mean much.
Well, it's looked to me like Bobby Jaggers has tried to attack Mike Graham on his strongest point, and that's the wrestling. Gordon, you can't go into a man, and there it is. There's a fall right out of the blue. Mike Graham was able to... Bobby Jaggers had the outside leg for a single leg takedown, Gordon. Mike Graham was able to slip behind him, rolling back. Right here we see a replay of it. Watch Mike Graham. He slips right in behind him. He throws that leg right in behind, grabs that black hanging leg out, gets it right there, figure four.
And back to action here as Jaggers attack Mike Graham again. Frustrated over a quick loss to Mike Graham, attacked him again, and now it is Mike Graham putting the finishing touches on Hangman Bobby Jaggers. He's back in now with a figure four. And if Jaggers had any protest before, he has no protest now, because Mike Graham has that figure four leg lock on him. And that is all over for Hangman Bobby Jaggers.
Well, Gordon, I'd say that's two straight in less than a minute for Mike Graham over Bobby Jaggers.
And Mr. Jaggers rolling to the outside of the ring. And there you see him. Mike Graham, as exactly as Jerry said, two very, very fast pinfalls on, one a pinfall, one a submission on Hangman Bobby Jaggers. Talking about men who go out and try and settle issues as quickly as possible, the man we're going to see in action right now. We have a couple of extra moments here, and I wasn't sure whether we're going to get the feature on or not. So, gentlemen, if you have that feature ready, I'd like to take a moment to explain. The man we're going to see in action right now is a masked competitor, Mr. Wrestling Number 2. Mr. Wrestling 2 travels in some very, very fast circles, and you see him here in action. Here's a man who has a penchant about his mask. His reasons for wearing that mask are purely psychological. He decries so many people who wear a mask for various reasons that would not be, well, it'd be subversive, as a matter of fact, in regards to the sport itself. And he wants people to know and recognize the fact, two things. Number one, that any masked competitor that he goes against, he's going to remove the mask. And number two, you better not mess with his whatsoever. Here we see him, this match, Mr. Wrestling 2, going up against Bruce Gallagher. Gallagher known as a Pier 6 brawler. But as you can see here, Wrestling 2 dominating the situation.
Wrestling 2, once he gets in that ring, Gordon, he's got one gear, and that's straight ahead. And believe me, Gordon, when he comes at you, as we're seeing right here, he's getting set for that strong knee. He can knock you from here to wherever he wants to take you, and it's usually out for the lights when he hits you with that strong knee.
And Wrestling 2, we'll tell you a little bit more about him a little bit later on regarding something that happened just this past week up in Kansas City. All of that is upcoming. I might point out that Wrestling 2 was kind enough to videotape some comments regarding his return to the great state of Florida, and we're all looking forward to that. He's a great competitor, as I've said before. I think Barbara's going to have some very, very interesting take fives with this man because his background is tremendously varied. He is a gentleman through and through, but one of the most dangerous men I've ever seen in the ring.
Well, he's dangerous, and he's got some very high-ranking friends, Gordon. As you said, Barbara Clary will have that in a future take five. But this man, he's world-known. He is a masked man who is proud to wear that mask, and I don't believe he's ever had it taken off of him yet.
I don't believe so either, Jerry, and I'll tell you what, let's listen right now to these previously recorded videotaped comments by Mr. Wrestling Number 2.
Well, here I am back in Florida. Mr. Wrestling 2, for those who don't know me or don't quite recognize me, you know, I'm going to spend a little time down here for the simple reason I've heard an awful lot about competition. You know, I'm one individual that thrives on competition. I like a challenge, just like each and every one of you that go to work each day. It's a challenge for you to see if you can accomplish your job at your best. And just like myself, I go everywhere I go, I do my best, and to see if I can accomplish my job the way I see fit. Florida, I'm coming your way. Be prepared. All you wrestlers down there, all you big tough guys, and even the ones that are great wrestlers, and I know Florida has a number of them, I'm looking forward to getting down there and wrestling each and every one of you, no matter who, where, or how.
Well, there you have it, the comments from Mr. Wrestling, too. He's a dead serious man when it comes to stepping into that ring, and he is, beyond a shadow of a doubt, action personified. And anytime, no matter where you happen to live, no matter where you happen to catch us here on the network, anytime you get a chance to see a man like Wrestling, too, or a man like Mike Graham, or the others that you'll be seeing here on Championship Wrestling, we certainly urge you to get out and see them in person. Watching them here on television is exciting, but seeing them live in action is just twice as exciting. And we'll be back with more action right after we pause for these words. There you see it, David Von Erich and the International Heavyweight Champion, Dory Funk Jr., scheduled to go against Charlie Cook and Reggie Parks. However, Charlie Cook and Mike Graham have joined me.
Gordon, Reggie was supposed to be in my apartment, but for some reason he missed his flight in Atlanta. And here, my main man over here, he volunteered his service.
Mike?
You know, Gordon, I'd never miss an opportunity to get in the ring with Dory Funk Jr. because there's a lot of unsettled business between he and I. David Von Erich, obviously great athlete, he's got a lot of potential, but I think he needs to be taught some Southern manners.
Well, fair enough. So we're going to see it. And David Von Erich having some words with the referee already. Charlie Cook and Mike Graham taking the place of the Iron Man, Reggie Parks. And so let's turn it over to our ring announcer for this Australian tag
match,
team
one match. Both a 10-minute time limit from Cleveland, Ohio, weighing 245 pounds, Charlie Cook. His partner from Tampa, Florida, weighing 219 pounds, Mike Graham. Their opponents from Shady Shores, Texas, weighing 225 pounds, David Von Erich. And from Amarillo, Texas, weighing 235 pounds, Dory Funk Jr.
Dory Funk Jr. and David Von Erich, and it's Mike Graham. As he said, he'll never miss an opportunity to wrestle against Dory Funk Jr. if he can get it. He's got it, and he moves against him very quickly. Up into the ring ropes, and it is Funk reversing the situation. Funk, caught him. Caught him with an elbow coming off the ropes. And there's that forearm of Dory Funk Jr. Another one that's got Mike Graham could be in trouble. Mike Graham staggered again. Dory Funk Jr. into the spinning toe hold on Mike Graham. Graham breaks it up. Beautiful counter by Mike Graham. Tried to go into the figure four, and it was countered by Dory Funk Jr. Boy, you talk about intensity. We've got it here.
Well, Gordon, I think Charlie Cook and Mike Graham pulled the right move by starting Mike. Mike was fresh. He just had that quick win over Bobby Jaggers. His adrenaline was flowing, so he made the right decision to come out. He's had the advantage. They got David Von Erich in a bad spot now. They got that arm. Mike was able to get over. He's tagged Charlie Cook right back on that arm, applying the pressure on it. Those long arms of David Von Erich. There's a nice spin out. Charlie Cook taking him to the mat. He's got some distance. Von Erich tries to come up with that drop kick. Cook drops back just a hair, and he tags Mike back in. Another fresh man.
All right, David Von Erich and Mike Graham tangling now. Mike Graham goes to the side. Headlock changes now, goes to the rear. Catches him in a hammerlock. Boy, I'm talking about, you talk about an outstanding match here. This would, this would fill Madison Square Garden, Kiel Auditorium, the Cow Palace, you name it. These four competitors, four of the top in the world today, and it's no wonder the Championship Wrestling 82 from Florida enjoys the reputation it does with competition of this caliber.
Well, it's world-class competition. These men are not only known here in Florida, they're world-famous. You can go to Sydney, Australia, anywhere, mention Mike Graham, Charlie Cook, Dory Funk Jr., Von Erich. They're going to know. Mike Graham tried for a farmer's carry. Show you the counter move. Funk countered it. Graham went right back. He had that leg. He drove him down with the thickness of his shoulders. You can see that shot there, Gordon. The development of Mike Graham's shoulder. He tried for the move. It was blocked by Funk, and he kept on carrying it through. That's the sign. Never quit your initial movement. Once you start, carry it through. You hesitate, you'll be in trouble.
Tag is made. Charlie Cook moves in, crashes down across the arm of Dory Funk Jr., then moves into an arm drag takedown. Funk Jr. back on the canvas once again. And it's Charlie Cook pressing that advantage.
Of course, Charlie Cook and Dory Funk Jr. goes back a few months, too. Cook took the Florida Heavyweight Championship from him, and Dory Funk Jr. is hot, hot, hot.
Mike Graham tags up, moves into the ring now. Mike Graham started to hook the arm. It was Funk twisting away, tried to move away. Mike Graham keeps the arm trapped now into a full-arm drag. Tried to make the tag with David Von Erich and missed. Graham pulled him short.
Positioning in the ring, and this only comes through experience here. Mike Graham's within arm's length of Charlie Cook at all times. He does. Dory Funk Jr. tried to tag, but he just couldn't quite reach over there. They've had the match in control. There you see control again. Just sheer mat control on the part of Graham and Cook.
Dory Funk Jr. getting that shoulder off just in time as Charlie Cook kept him tied up. Funk now trying to turn a disadvantage into an advantage. And Bill Alfonso down there. Some excellent officiating here. Funk Jr. rolls, dropped an elbow, but it was Charlie Cook catching him. That time, Dory Funk Jr. slipped away from a drop kick, and Charlie Cook having some problems. He came right down on the side of his hip. Ooh! Von Erich lashed out with a boot that time, caught Charlie Cook in the side of the jaw. Has him slowed down, and Von Erich now a standing drop kick. Has Charlie Cook back to the canvas once again. David Von Erich, a second-generation wrestler, as is Dory Funk Jr. and Mike Graham, all three of them second-generation competitors. And the intensity, the rivalry between the Funks and the Grahams beginning to evidence itself here. And Mike Graham himself saying what he did about David Von Erich, saying that he thought he might need a little lesson in Southern manners. And right now, David Von Erich and Dory Funk Jr. trying to take the measure on Charlie Cook, and Charlie Cook would be well served to get over there and make that tag if he can, but they're blocking him very effectively.
They are, Gordon. They're keeping Charlie Cook at their side of the ring. They're keeping him in their corner. Cook needs to try to work his way over to the other side. He's in a neutral corner now, and when Funk has you in that corner and he lays those uppercut forearms in there, you better watch out, Gordon, because he can knock you silly.
Caught him beautifully that time, coming off the canvas, got him with another good shoulder block into the midsection. Now Charlie Cook exploding on Dory Funk Jr. Charlie Cook catches him. That could be all she wrote for Dory Funk Jr. Charlie Cook moves into the lateral press for the no, sir. Funk powered out once again. Tremendous credit has to go to this man, Funk. Funk makes the tag with David Von Erich. David Von Erich, both men attacking Charlie Cook, and now Mike Graham enters the fray. And we've got a fierce sixer between David Von Erich and Mike Graham. Meanwhile, Dory Funk Jr. continues to punish Charlie Cook. Mike Graham charges in the far corner, caught with a knee by David Von Erich. And the referee knocked to one side as David Von Erich caught with a shoulder block. It's Mike Graham catching him in a rolling reverse into a saddle block. He's got him down, and it is Dory Funk Jr. catching up with Mike Graham. And Mike Graham tied up in those ropes. And Charlie Cook slowly and laboriously coming back to his feet. And they're double-teaming Charlie Cook. They're double-teaming Charlie Cook. And Charlie Cook in a lot of trouble here. And it is David Von Erich now going to the spinning toehold on Charlie Cook. Mike Graham still trapped in those ropes. The referee on hand, and Charlie Cook, those shoulders are down, and we've got a big problem here. The bell has rung, and it is Charlie Cook double-teamed and defeated. And Mike Graham still in those ropes, and David Von Erich bringing him up. Graham catches him, caught him with a short chopping right hand that dropped David Von Erich to the... Now it is, Dory Funk Jr. trapping Mike Graham. Oh! David Von Erich literally spitting in the face of Mike Graham. Graham hurtled from the ropes. And it is Dory Funk Jr. and David Von Erich leaving the ring area. Mike Graham back in there in a picture of rage if I've ever seen one. Mike Graham, but also concerned about Charlie Cook, will be back. We'll be back in just a moment. Championship Wrestling returns to West Palm Beach in the West Palm Beach Auditorium this coming Monday night, January 4th. The first matches of the 1982 wrestling season. A number to call for advanced ticket information, 683-6012. And this coming Monday night, what a night of wrestling competition. The Florida heavyweight champion, the Spoiler, defends his title against the challenge of Killer Carl Cox. The North American Tag Team Champions, Jack and Jerry Briscoe, will be defending their titles against the challenge of Iron Mike and Chan Chung. In a special challenge match, it will be Mike Graham against Hangman Bobby Jaggers. Jaggers requesting this match, and I might say that it should prove to be interesting indeed. In a TV title match, it will be J.J. Dillon going after the new Florida TV champion, Eric Embry. Mr. Onita takes on Ron Ritchie. David Sierra faces Tim Horner. Masa Fuji wrestles against Coco Samoa. All of this action Monday night in West Palm Beach at the West Palm Beach Auditorium. Killer Carl Cox had these comments regarding the Florida Heavyweight Championship.
There's no sense of me standing here wasting your time or my time. I'm not going to beat around the bush. I'm going to tell you what I'm here after. That is a Florida title. The Spoiler has it, and I'm going to get it. Now I can see Mr. Jim Dillon. It's his old nasty doggy self. He's hiding behind other wrestlers. He's making a lot of comments about me, telling a lot of lies. They're all lies. You all know that. I don't have to tell you what I'm capable of doing. You all know what this ex-Marine can do, because sometimes I bug off a little bit and I don't know what I'm doing myself. But it's a title that I'm after. and I think it's what I will get. So thank you very much, Mr. Dillon, for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
J.J. Dillon, the Florida heavyweight champion, the spoiler, and Iron Mike, some 285 pounds of him from Canada, have some comments regarding this coming Monday night in West Palm Beach at the auditorium.
Last week, Killer Carl Cox, everybody in the state of Florida saw you on statewide television from the matches in Orlando come out of the rafters like the rat that you are and come into the ring and steal my moment of glory when the spoiler took a very, very clear-cut decisive win over one of the top challengers in Wahoo McDaniels. You kind of caught me at a moment when I really wasn't expecting to see you. You were the last thing I expected to see. 8 years ago in Australia, it's a long, long time, Killer Carl Cox. I tried everything to get you turned around in the right direction to do something with you, but the problem is that between your temples, there is nothing on the inside. The only thing that it takes to get your attention is to hit you with something such as a ball-peen hammer. But I see something in that beautiful television trophy, and if I can go out, not if I can go out, when I go out and take it from Eric Embry, I'm going to grab it from the other end. I'm going to hit Killer Carl Cox between the eyes, and then once I've got his attention, the rest is up to the spoiler. There will not be a reoccurrence of what took place last week. It won't be long till we see Cox on his way out of the state.
Monday night, West Palm Beach. Myself, Iron Mike Sharp, Canada's strongest man, greatest wrestler, greatest athlete. All those things pertain to me. And my partner, the great Chinese wrestler, Chan Chung. We take on the so-called North American title holders, the Briscoe brothers. Well, I want to tell you something. You're smaller than us, and you haven't got as much brains as we do, and we're going to show you. We're going to show you come Monday night in West Palm when we leave that ring with the title around our waist and our hands raised.
Some very definitive comments from one Iron Mike, and we'll be seeing him in action this coming Monday night at the West Palm Beach Auditorium. Eric Embry is with me right now. Eric, in facing J.J. Dillon, this man, he's really been a thorn in his side.
You know, Mr. Sully, he's been a thorn in my side, too. Look at my face, my head. J.J. Dillon, you're responsible for all of it. But that's okay, I don't care. Hey, man, I'm sitting on top of the world, Mr. Sully. I can't express what I feel inside. I'm so happy. You know, I won the TV championship, and, you know, I can't explain what that means to me. Now I've got something you want, J.J. Dillon, but let's get one thing straight. I hate you as much as you hate me, and there ain't no way, baby. This trophy don't belong to me. It belongs to the people. I want to be the people's champion, a champion they can be proud of, not like the Squalor. I want to be like the Briscoe brothers, something they can be proud of.
Thank you so very much. You'll see Eric Embry and all of the others in action this coming Monday night at the West Palm Beach Auditorium.
Association and your local
Dory Funk Jr. and myself, we've had our differences in the ring, and he's come back and he started out where you left off. But let me tell you something, Dory Funk. If you want me, what you did to my ring is just an example of what I'm gonna do to you. Anytime you and that punk Von Erich, just come on and get me because I'm ready for you.
Charlie, I know how you feel, but I think you'd better have that eye looked at, Charlie.
Don't worry about that, Gordon. Just worry about Dory fucking Erich.
You okay, babe? Far be it for me to argue with Charlie Cook right now, but I hope he does have that eye looked after because it is swelling very, very rapidly. Let's turn it over to our ring announcer.
This match is 1-4-8, 10-minute time limit from the Isle of Samoa, weighing 228 pounds, Coco Samoa. His partner from Jacksonville, Florida, weighing 220 pounds, Bob Russell. Their opponents from Canada, weighing 285 pounds, Iron Mike Sharp. His partner from Hong Kong, weighing 260 pounds, Chan Chung.
Mike and Chan Chung going up against Coco Samoa and Bob Russell. And Chan Chung, another masked competitor. Speaking about masks, I might just mention at this particular time that we had talked about the return of Avalanche Tyler. The very, very near future, but Mr. Tyler will not be joining us. It seems as though Mr. Wrestling number two in Kansas City just this past week went into a match against a competitor by the name of the Jackal, Jerry. And it turned out that the Jackal was defeated by Wrestling 2. And Wrestling 2 proceeded to unmask him, and it turned out to be Avalanche Tyler. Well, Tyler was under suspension, as you know. And he had not yet completed his suspension, and now he is suspended, well, it could be indefinitely. But Mr. Dillon has got his problems, and he does not have Avalanche Tyler at his beck and call anymore.
Like you got to Mr. Dillon's goat there, Gordon.
Yeah, he came by and then suddenly left. So apparently Mr. Dillon is more than somewhat displeased over what's happened. Chan Chung moving very effectively, and this is a dangerous man. Impossible to tell who he is, but you can certainly tell by his physical development that he is a very, very large, powerful man.
He is, Gordon, and obviously with a name like Chan Chung, we'd just assume that he is from the Orient. J.J. Dillon combs the world looking for talent. When he finds them, he likes to keep them a secret, whether by design or whether he has to put masks on these people, we don't know. But he certainly has two capable wrestlers in his Chan Chung and Iron Mike. His Iron Mike is a tremendously built type of person. He's powerful, he's strong, very deliberate in the moves he goes. He goes straight forward all the time.
Well, he too is a second-generation wrestler, and he's from Canada. And he played just about every sport imaginable in his high school and college career. And why he is, only he and J.J. Dillon know why he's joined Dillon's forces.
Money, Gordon.
Yeah.
Chan Chung, J.J. Dillon flashes that check, look around. That's what it's all about in the world of sports.
Keeping the pressure on one Bob Russell. Now Russell having his problems. Coco Samoa exploding on Chan Chung. Iron Mike steps into that ring, and he's caught by Coco Samoa.
Coco Samoa is full of fire. When it comes for Coco, boy, he slows down for nobody. There he caught that foot, and Chan Chung is bringing him up. Reverse-type backbreaker, a little bit different. He has Coco Samoa in a world of hurt right now.
Iron Mike makes the tag, and it's Iron Mike moving in. Iron Mike brought him up, has him in, a sort of a vertical gut wrench, and Coco Samoa conceding as those muscles in the back being stretched in the wrong directions. Also, those abdominal muscles being stretched. And there you see him, J.J. Dillon, without the services of one Avalanche Tyler. But he's got a tremendously powerful pair here in Iron Mike and Chan Chung. And I wanted to ask Mr. Dillon some comments about that, but he left the desk before we had a chance to talk to him, and he's upset, obviously, about Avalanche Tyler.
This week's Take 5, I'm with the new Southern Heavyweight Champion, David Von Erich, and Dory Funk Jr. has also joined us. Thank you both for being here.
Thank you.
You know, I think both of you and Jack Briscoe deserve a lot of credit in your match. You, because you were a substitute, you were not originally supposed to be fighting, and Jack Briscoe, because he did put the title on the line.
Well, that's true. Jack Briscoe was a fantastic champion, and he still is, in my mind. He did accept it with me stepping in. I defeated the man. A lot of people are talking about David Von Erich being an up-and-coming young star. Well, I'm already here, baby. It's not up-and-coming anymore. I am now the Southern Heavyweight Champion, which is just one belt and one more star in my crown.
You know, Barbara, when I pick a partner, someone that I'm going to be associated with, I like to pick a winner. David Von Erich just beat Jack Briscoe for the Southern Heavyweight Championship. Jack Briscoe is as good as you can get. So I've got a man for a partner, a man to watch in professional wrestling that you people are going to see a lot of. And I know some things about David Von Erich that a lot of these people probably don't. He comes from an athletic family. He has three brothers that are excellent athletes. His father was a great professional wrestler. He has everything that it takes to be a champion in professional wrestling. He is a champion, and he will be. Here we're looking at the match with David Von Erich against Jack Briscoe coming from Bayfront Arena. And you can see David is in control of the situation, even against a man like Jack Briscoe.
Well, it was a great night for me. Like I said, it was a star in my crown, and beating a great man like Jack Briscoe, he caught me there, as you can see. But beating a great man like Jack Briscoe was definitely fantastic. It was the greatest moment in my life. And the next great one would be beating the next world champion. And, man, I throw a few bouquet of roses at the man standing next to me here, Mr. Bill Frank Jr., because I've been an admirer of his for a very, very long time. He is, to me, the greatest world champion that has ever been.
I'm sure a lot of the wrestling fans know that the Von Erichs and the Funks have had their problems. We've fought each other a lot. We have a lot of respect for each other, too. And you're going to see a lot of David Von Erich in the future. You're going to see him as my partner on occasions, and you'll see him in single matches on occasions, and you'll see him doing some things that the Funk brothers do a good job at.
How did it feel to fight a legend like Jack Briscoe for a title?
You can't put that into words. That is, it's the ultimate to fight a champion like him and beat him. The main thing was that I beat the man, and I don't want anybody to forget that. He is a champion, like I said before, but I did defeat him, and I'm very happy about it.
I've got to say this, Barbara. I was surprised when I heard that David Von Erich defeated Jack Briscoe, but I know that Dave is the kind of an athlete, he's in the kind of condition that he can, on a given day, beat a man like Jack Briscoe. I heard that he did it, and we're watching it right now. Here's how it happens. David Von Erich, the winner over Jack Briscoe. Right there you see, no question, Jack Briscoe's shoulders flat on the mat. New Southern Heavyweight Champion, David Von Erich.
No doubt. No doubt at all. He fell right on top of him because he was laying right there, and he was meat on the hoof. And I took it just the way I should.
Well, it was certainly an exciting match, and I want to thank the new Southern Heavyweight Champion, David Von Erich, and also, of course, Dory Funk Jr. for being here. That's our Take 5 for this week.
Television time remaining, and the gentleman in the blue trunk certainly needs no introduction. He is Les Thornton, the world junior heavyweight champion, moving out against a man who's a native of Havana, Cuba, David Sierra, now makes his home in Portland, Oregon, and a tremendous opportunity for David Sierra.
Well, it is. David Sierra wants this match very much, and you know, Gordon, the action of this match, we miss the little things here that Les Thornton does that makes him the junior heavyweight champion of the world. Some of the wing overs here, you see, he kicks that little foot in there. He trips you up. He keeps his feet moving all the time. And Les Thornton's a man of 1,001 holds. He applies just about all of them in the course of a match. You've got to be on your toes at all times to come up with a counter against this man.
Tremendously talented competitor, and beautiful deep double underhook into a takedown by Thornton, and right back into an arm drag. Good move by Sierra as he hung on tenaciously. And the new Florida television champion has joined us, Eric Embry. Eric has been to the doctors, and what's the prognosis, Eric?
Well, Mr. Sully, you know, they said the back was bruised up a little bit to take a few days off. And, you know, I'd just like to thank all the people for backing me, Mr. Sully, and it was a pleasure to have Ron Ritchie to wrestle for the TV championship. And, you know, this man, Les Thornton, you know, the people who are watching him, you know, what an athlete he is.
He is a great athlete. I might just point up, not only the back is bruised up, but you take a look at Eric's eye here. He's showing the scars of battle, but nice to have Eric Embry back with us now. And, of course, he is the recipient of the trophy and the Florida TV championship. And it's David Sierra now pressing an advantage here on Les Thornton, the world junior heavyweight champion, and Sierra acquitting himself extremely well thus far, but he's got to be on his guard all the time because you don't slip in front of Les Thornton.
Well, that's right, Gordon. David Sierra, as we mentioned, it's an important match to him. He wants to keep the momentum going in his favor. He's been able to tie up that base of support, being the arm. been able to keep Les Thornton on the mat. If you're able to keep Les down and keep him tied up, you're out of trouble. Once you give him an opening, he starts applying those moves to you, you're in trouble. But David Sierra has had the momentum going. You see, he just really hangs onto that arm. He's not giving Thornton a breather at all. He's keeping the pressure on him.
And time continues to rapidly run down. David Von Erich, and I would have to say, if I were Jack Briscoe, after what I saw during that take five, I would be more than somewhat upset over that Southern Heavyweight Championship. Certainly, however, there was no question in the manner in which, Eric, you won your Florida TV title. Again, our congratulations.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sullivan.
Time is rapidly running out here. Neither man thus far able to gain a pinfall. So at this time, speaking on behalf of Barbara Clary, Jerry Briscoe, and our new Florida TV champion, Eric Embry, Gordon Solie saying so long.